All members are present, and we will now move to public comment relating to any item on the agenda this afternoon. Each speaker will have 2 minutes to address the committee, and whoever would like to start, please come forward.
Hi there, my name is Dave. He had addressed this group before, so I don't want to sound like a broken record. I'll go over sort of my main focus and my involvement in disaster preparedness. And that focus is about community-based disaster preparedness and how that really should be the focus in terms of building resilient communities. I know that Councilmember Weingraff was concerned at the last meeting after I spoke, basically saying, you know, we can't give up training of our professional first responders in order to have a community-based approach to disaster preparedness. And I completely agree. Professional first responders need excellent training, and I'm all for that. But I think almost everybody in this room agrees that Sheriff Ahern's structure in Urban Shield is highly problematic. And what I would say is that that is a structure that Berkeley does not need to engage in terms of getting excellent training. There's lots of ways to do that. But I understand why it's nervous making for city council members to leave a known structure and embark on something unknown. I would kind of equate it to your decision to leave Wells Fargo, understanding that Wells Fargo is a really problematic financial institution and one that Berkeley really doesn't want to engage with. But you have no structure to go to after that. It's really difficult work, right? You've got a task force that is working hard to develop some other financial institutions and systems in order to fill that void. And I'm not saying that this is going to be easy, but actually, frankly, I think it's going to be a lot easier to get the kind of training that our first responders, our professional first responders, truly need. And I would say that, as I've said before, that leaving Urban Shield is an opportunity. I really hope you can see it in that light. This basically disaster preparedness, when a disaster happens, as we all know, the very definition is that our professional first responders and our systems are overwhelmed. And basically, what we're looking for is a way to have our communities as a whole be able to be resilient enough in terms of response, but also for preparing in order to handle those kinds of massive, overwhelming situations. And what I'm hoping is that our pulling away from Urban Shield will help this city take a look at how it approaches disaster preparedness and turn it on its head and say, yes, absolutely, the police, the fire department, Office of Emergency Services, everyone should get the training that they need and deserve. We recently had the experience of a shooting last week. We had the balcony collapse. Both of those instances were situations where people turned to the training that the responders had and said, look, this is what they learned at Urban Shield. They learned how to use tourniquets. They learned how to deal with chest collapsed lungs and those kinds of things. That's why we have to stay in Urban Shield. My response would be to say, absolutely, that training is fabulous and should be extended beyond the 10 people who attend the Urban Shield training. Let's pull out and rethink that. Let's give that kind of training to all of the professional first responders. So I applaud this committee in terms of making the decision at the last meeting and saying, I fully support you. I hope you know that there are those people who are very involved in disaster preparedness who say, absolutely, this is the right direction to go. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Katrin Behrham. I'm a teacher at Cal. I also live on the corner of Essex Street and Wheeler, and was totally traumatized by the police PR stunt that we had there on Wednesday. until this morning when I read up on what actually happened, I deeply rethought my stance to Urban Shield, because I was by the police PR campaign and the panic that was spread over my entire neighborhood. I was led to believe that there was an explosive involving hostage situation in my neighborhood, and that it needed to be locked down, and that we needed SWAT training, and that, you know, for my life and my students' life was going to visit me, maybe we needed Urban Shield. You know, what really happened was that there's an elderly white, you know, guy who shoots his own tenant and then goes home. Do we need SWAT training for that? No. You know, we need people who've learned that that's a human emergency, that that's not a time to pull all your SWAT training out. You know, this distress, what we need is healthcare. You know, what caused the black tenant to not pay for his rent? What we need is de-escalation on the housing market. We need trained professionals to reach out in those cases when there's clearly already a housing dispute. And we need a police PR that at least acknowledges who the first responders were, which were the guards at the cannabis club. Yeah? We also need a situation where a black tenant who gets threatened to be killed by his own landlord is actually comfortable to call 911. Why did he not call 911? That's what you gotta ask yourself, and I think the militarized training of Urban Shield is the answer to that. Thank you.
My name is Casey Carpenter. I'm a resident of Berkeley over on Acton Street, and I definitely want to support the City Council's recommendation to not participate in the Urban Shield very narrow use case for tactical training. I think that, first, I very much respect and appreciate our trained professionals in emergency police and fire departments, but I don't think we need planning and training for our entire community, and we need to make sure that it includes a broader set of use cases, including fire, earthquake, and the daily conditions that happen every single day. Because the first responder is actually someone like me. You know, if we do have a situation where we need to have neighborhood blocks that are trained, we need to have communications, not only authority to authority, but citizen to citizen. And we need to look at all the stakeholders. It's not just our public safety, it's our hospitals, it's our schools, it's our universities, it's our businesses, it's our restaurants, it's our residents and visitors. So imagine it's a hot summer day in Berkeley. The earthquake hits. Most of the parents are not here. They've commuted to work. Their children are in the schools, right? Gridlock. We've got issues on BART, the buses, there's fires. So this is the type of scenario we need to make sure that all of our residents are trained. So they're the first responders. They may not have the fortune to have a trained professional for a couple of days. Will they have, do they have water? Do they have a communication system? So I'm actually now retired, but I spent 2 decades at Cisco Systems leading public safety initiatives globally. And we actually have probably worked with Berkeley, I'm sure we have, in terms of interoperable communications. I was actually the lead for the International Association of Chief of Police Community Policing Award. I would love it if Berkeley develops a plan that could be recognized as a world-class end-to-end community policing program. Not just the narrow focus of Urban Shield. Thank you very much. I'm happy to provide additional input.
I said my time to the speaker. I live in District 3. My name is Annette Perskovitz.
Okay, thank you so much. So, you know, at Cisco, we actually developed a methodology that looked at a whole set of use case communication flows. We call it COPS, Cisco Open Platform for Public Safety. And so when you start to look at the day-to-day use cases and you start to look at the communication flows, Urban Shield training doesn't go anywhere near the readiness we need in Berkeley. Now, this isn't the fault of our police organizations or emergency response. This is actually your responsibility. You need to engage with your constituents in this community, the businesses, the restaurants, the universities, the schools. What about the people that live in the nursing homes, our aging population? What about the visitors? What if there's a big sports event at Berkeley the same day this happens? The first responder is us. And so I know that this group of trained professionals absolutely wants this training, but we need the right training that's going to meet the outcomes. We need to make sure we identify the use cases. I'm sure you have an excellent manual here at City Hall or in the police department, But we need to make sure that that training guide, that emergency response documentation, is actually implemented. Are we engaging with the churches and the synagogues and the schools? Most of the people, 99% of our community, does not have time to come on a Monday afternoon and speak to you. But we need to represent them in this plan. So I'm going to put a lot of effort into making sure that that community is represented. I also lead a number of political activism groups in Berkeley, and we will continue to make this a key issue. And I really appreciate your listening to our input today, and also your understanding why this community is bringing this to your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
My name is Victoria Legg, and I'm a member of the Disaster Fire Safety Commission. Berkeley Side recently reported statistics on violent crime rates, which have been increasing by double digits over each of the last 3 years. So far this year, Berkeley Side headlines referenced 28 reported gun-related incidents, 13 more than of all of 2017. The mayor has repeatedly commended Berkeley PD for its great track record over the years, and has written, it has some of the best trained and most educated officers and has avoided the type of scandals that plague many agencies. We value and respect our officers and want to help them do their jobs. And yet, recent efforts by council to manage how Berkeley's police department works in the community are not effective or supportive of the department, as evidenced by the number and caliber of officers taking early retirement or jobs where there are better working conditions, and have made clear the reason for leaving is that training, specialized assignments, and community support are now lacking in Berkeley. This council is ignoring the nuts and bolts of municipal government, which is public safety and potholes. The fact that there are far more bullets flying around from guns in the hands of civilians than bullets discharged by our officers is a very real threat to our community, and which seems to be ignored. Members of council turn a deaf ear to the professional opinion of our city manager, our fire chief, and our police chief on the need for sophisticated hands-on training and how to retain desirable officers, who, over the years, developed highly skilled and professional policing practices in a uniquely progressive, community-oriented, yet complex city. And in the absence of a credible and operational alternative, I support the police department's position that hands-on urban shield participation is invaluable to their officers. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. Paul Degenkolb, Chair of the Disaster and Fire Safety Commission. I just discovered in the report I have a second thing I'd like to get. But first, my basic statement. Urban Shield is about training first responders for rare events. These events, ranging from disastrous accidents to terror attacks, are rare but damaging to the community they occur in. In any of these situations, including fires, earthquake, active shooters, etc., fire department, police department, and medical first responders will have to work together under intense physical and emotional strains that will last for periods from hours to days. In all of these scenarios, the police will be required to provide crowd control, minimize crimes of opportunity, and remove human threats. It is critical that all first responders train together to deal with these situations in as realistic a form as possible. However, it is the police that have to separate out threats and potential victims in a very short time, and ensuring the minimum possible harm to the community. So it is critical that the police are provided training to respond appropriately to these emergencies. While prevention, de-escalation, and preparedness are important parts of the first responder's job, all of these skills are embodied in the continual mandated training required for all of our professionals, first responders. The Urban Shield exercises, on the other hand, are a once-a-year, short, intense set of exercises to help prepare the first responders to deal with unexpected and, yes, violent events that are not easily covered in the classroom. Not providing for this training will result in the unnecessary loss of innocent lives. On that basis, it would be criminal not to take full advantage of this type of training whenever available. It is critical to the safety of the community that our first responders, including police, be encouraged to take the fullest possible advantage of any training offered through Urban Shield. I realize I'm over my time, but...
Okay, thank you.
Okay, this should only take a second. I was going through the draft report to council, and on page 2 it says that the chair of the police review and the chair of the disaster fire safety commission are non-voting members of this commission. I have received one invitation. I have sent several requests to find out when these meetings are held. I have never gotten that communication through anything else. And the last meeting that I attended, which was not the last meeting, but the one before, Mr. Aragon, you questioned why I was even there. So I don't think it's appropriate to say that I was a member of this commission in any manner, form, or shape. Thank you.
I don't recall, sir, what you're referring to with regard to questioning your attendance at a meeting. All members of the public are welcome to attend and speak at our meetings. So.
You don't, okay.
Hello, my name is Sarah Jones. I'm a CERT volunteer, and I have been trying to work with our businesses in the city of Berkeley to be more prepared. So just so you know that something is going on some of the time. I'm very disappointed in the subcommittee's decision to not allow our police to participate in Urban Shield this fall or in the future. I find it very troubling that professional police who have served our community, some for several decades, get some of their tactical training opportunities taken away by elected officials who are not working in the field. I must assume that they are being judged based on other police departments' behavior. Therefore, they have been found guilty of lacking the ability to understand our city's wishes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Lori Lerman, and I'm in Sochi Han's district. I live in Berkeley and vote. And I support the Urban Shield subcommittee motion on Berkeley's participation in the 2018 Urban Shield. And I wanted to just say that the Urban Shield represents to me the militarization of the police forces in our community and makes it seem to me that the citizens are the enemy, you know, are the ones who have the fear. And that this is happening across the United States, but this is Berkeley. I was there, Mr. Mayor, when you did the circle in the park, we all formed up peace symbol and, you know, had hope. Berkeley can be the Republic of Berkeley. We can show leadership to the rest of the nation that we can use training funds for the kind of disasters that we know might happen, as opposed to this kind of tactical military training, which is being forced on us. There are only tanks in the streets of Berkeley. Berkeley has shown leadership. When I was getting my master's degree in transit planning, I used Berkeley as an example because we had Donald Appleyard's transit, you know, system for pedestrians, and now we've got these bicycle boulevards. Now New York City has bicycle boulevards. Berkeley can be a leader, and I urge you to step up and take that leadership and use the training in the proper way. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Cindy Shanman, and I live in District 4, and I am here representing McGee Spalding Neighbors in Action, and we have been circulating a petition where we have approximately 974 signatures. And I'd just like to read to you the petition. To the mayor and city council, the undersigned residents, businesses, and civic organizations of Berkeley urgently call on the mayor and city council to discontinue all participation by the Berkeley Police Department in Urban Shield training and redirect funding and attention to public safety programs to better prepare our city in the face of disasters. Urban Shield is presented as a training program for emergency preparedness, but it is a highly militarized training geared to respond to unlikely terrorism scenarios, active shooters, and to sell military equipment. Several city council members observed the 2017 Urban Shield training and reported there was minimal training for natural disasters such as earthquakes or fires. We object to Urban Shield's highly militarized training of the Berkeley police because a 2014 ACLU report analyzed the militarization of the police and found that the deployment of SWAT teams disproportionately impacted people of color. The militarized tools made available through Urban Shield are going to a police department that has a demonstrated pattern of racial bias and profiling. The risks of terror-related attacks that Urban Shield trains for are low. Emergency personnel can be prepared for these incidents without becoming militarized. Washington Post research shows that when police are trained using militarized equipment, they are more likely to become involved in the violent use of force. As a sanctuary city, we are opposed to a program that promotes increased militarization that is often used against immigrant communities. The Urban Shield training focus on terrorism undermines the development of robust, regionally coordinated emergency preparedness training for natural disasters. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Adrienne Aaron. I'm a citizen. I'm a psychologist. I'm a member of my neighborhood CERT team and the author of the survey that on police priorities that was conducted last year. The survey found that people from all over the community share the concerns that I and my North Berkeley neighbors have about what we want our police to be doing so that we, as Berkeley residents, can feel safe. We found that people want the training of our police to emphasize such things as understanding mental health-related behaviors and de-escalating violent situations, and being sensitive to cultural differences. In other words, to focus on areas that will help assure people that the police are on our side and doing things to make us feel safe. When training emphasizes attack as a way of taking control of situations, it becomes harder for us to feel safe because that tends to make situations more violent rather than less so. It becomes harder for people to call the police for help because they cannot trust that the police are there to help them. So often when we read about police shootings, the story involves accusations of excessive and unnecessary force and injustice. When the emphasis in training is on attack, the subtle message to the police is that you and I are the enemy, not the people they're here to serve and protect, but the enemy. So I say, to emphasize what other people have said, let's have the Berkeley police conduct their and design their own training. We are members of the community who are here to help. I, as a psychologist, will volunteer my time to help to train ourselves on how best to serve this community. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ellen Brasky from District 5. I've been here many times. I've been following the whole discussion, and I want to say that I really appreciate the fact that the community is getting involved in this discussion on many different platforms. That's a great thing. It's important for citizens to really think about what kind of preparation and training they want for ourselves as well as their professional first responders. I am a little concerned, however, based on things that have happened recently on Nixol and Nextdoor. I just want to be clear that the police department is an agency of the city of Berkeley. I went back and I checked the organizational chart for the city of Berkeley, and it tells me that citizens are there, then are the elected council, who then, and a couple of commissions are elected, who then appoint commissioners to, and down at the bottom are the city departments. So a recent posting on Nixol which describe usually a very routine, there's a very routine description of the crime scene, took great pains to laud the example of how this showed that urban shield was so needed for the city of Berkeley. And I just want to appeal to the city manager and to the professionalism of the city staff at Berkeley to just make sure that you leave, let's leave the discussion and the debate and the eventual recommendation to our city council and to our citizens. And let's remember that you work for all of us. I don't want to worry that because I came out and spoke publicly against something that the police department feels so strongly about, I need to be worried in Berkeley. So I wanted to bring that to your attention. I also just wanted to share, is anybody willing to cede time?
Yes, my name is Carol Sanders. I'd like to cede my time to Ellen.
Thank you.
I just also wanted to share a very thoughtful response to by Tracy Rosenberg of the Media Alliance to a letter that was written by former Mayor Shirley Dean, which unfortunately contributes greatly to a lot of misunderstandings and misconceptions about urban shields. But what I specifically want to address is that the Alameda County Board of Supervisors has resolved that urban shield, as it's currently held, will be ended as of 2019. So we really do need to think, as the city of Berkeley, what do we want to do to reconstitute trainings that work for us? In particular, the decision was made due to several recent revelations which were of great concern to the Alameda County Board. Among them were the secretive presence of ICE, HSI, at the 2017 SWAT training, even though there had been discussions for a year or so about reforming urban shields. And the problem with sanctuary cities participating in the training of ICE personnel to terrorize immigrant families we have sworn repeatedly to protect. Another issue was the participation of Blackwater, the notorious foreign mercenary force, in providing discretionary urban shield funding. A third problem was the link between urban shield and the King Abdullah Special Operations Training Center in Amman, Jordan, which trains secret police from all over the world, including those who hold up bishops' dictators and whose training director is a retired 22-year member of the Alameda County Sheriff's Department who was instrumental in setting up the first Urban Shield event. So what these revelations tell us is that the Urban Shield event, as it has been run, is deeply problematic for progressive cities that wish to live up to their values. And so I would just like to echo what other people are saying, is that it's time for the whole Bay Area, not just Berkeley, but the whole Bay Area to move on from Urban Shield, and let's do something that's more in line with our progressive values and the idea of whole community preparation and resilience. And thank you for all your hard work. I really appreciate that. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is John Lindsay with the American Friends Service Committee. Again, thank you for your work on this. Some of the proponents of urban shields and supporters have said that because of its repeated exposure to live shooter situations, this helps Berkeley police act, quote, without thinking. And I want to posit that, unfortunately, the action that urban shield is inducing in the vast majority of the tactical scenarios is shooting to kill. So this is what a police trainer from Bulletproof named Dave Grossman has called conditioned response. And it's what the military learned about its own training, which is that what you need in order to kill. The vast majority of urban shield scenarios do not admit the possibility of de-escalation or non-fatalities. SWAT teams seeking to win the urban shield competition are not penalized for eliminating suspects in the role plays, according to the scoring sheet, which I will pass around here. That is used in order to rate the teams. And in one urban shield scenario that one of us witnessed, that I witnessed as an observer this past year, the actual event on which the scenario was based, which was a gunman at Children's Hospital in Oakland, was actually resolved without any shooting or deaths, while in the urban shield scenario we required killing the gunman. Some officers have said that Berkeley SWAT's participation in urban shield hasn't led to shootings by PPD officers. But there are at least two killings by PPD officers who participated in Urban Shield of armed suspects in 2008 and 2010. I would say that these were of Nia Gay and of Chung Van Yun. It would be speculative to conclude whether either of these killings could have been avoided with different protocols or training, but they did occur, and they should not be erased by claims that these shootings did not happen.
I cede my time.
Okay, thank you very much.
Some supporters say it's key for the police, fire, and medical responders to train together, but in what I saw in observing this and by design, the SWAT team from Berkeley competes alone in Urban Shield, separate from other Berkeley participants. Some proponents have said that by participating in this last year, Berkeley could attempt to reform Urban Shield from within. I believe this approach is unrealistic. Berkeley has no seat at the table in designing Urban Shield this year. But what's more, even more important is that the office of Sheriff Gregory Ahern, which makes the decisions about Urban Shield, has demonstrated repeatedly that it cannot be trusted to fulfill commitments to reform. In addition to what Ellen mentioned, the Sheriff's Office committed to guidelines last year, a dozen different guidelines that were violated in last year's Urban Shield, including against surveillance training and other kinds of training. It is not about punishing the sheriff or punishing the police department, but about how unreliable the sheriff is to enact reforms that are incompatible with Berkeley values. Berkeley has other priorities for emergency preparedness with a much greater capability deficit and level of need than BPD's preparation for terrorist or even active shooter incidents. These include community preparation for disasters, including for shooter incidents, and fire prevention, both in the hills, where there's growing excess brush, and in flatlands, where there are major subsurface gas lines. I want to just conclude by responding to the letter that Shirley Dean sent to all of you. There are a number of errors in that letter, and this is a response just to the errors that were in the Urban Shield section of that letter. There were just so many errors that, to me, the whole letter has questionable value. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
My name is Daniel Orbstrom. I'm a Berkeley resident, living within walking distance of here. And I'm speaking for Veterans for Peace, and we urge the city of Berkeley to, and any all other cities also, to totally disengage from police militarization. For myself, and you've all heard me say this probably 50 times, but let me say it again. I spent 4 years in the U.S. Marine Corps, and in the belief that I was helping to defend our country against bad guys, supposedly foreigners naturally, who take over and impose a police state. And that's essentially what I see Urban Shield being. I have had some experience with this. I was at the, 1 year ago, June 20th, I was at that city council hearing, and that hearing was taken over by the police. You were all there, you probably remember it very well. That was a flat-out attack on democracy. That is police militarization. That is the imposition of a police state. I wrote an article about my experience that evening. I'd like to leave that for a copy for each of you.
Thank you.
And anybody else who wants a copy, I have more copies here. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Clyde Leland. I live down the street in Councilmember Hahn's district. I'm here because I think that I should do everything I can to oppose the increase in militarization of this nation at this point, not just our police force and the polarization that's happening. And I want to urge my elected representatives to do the same, to take a stand. I think it matters. I think it matters to what's happening in this country if Berkeley takes a stand and takes leadership on this issue. I have support the Urban Shield Subcommittee's motion, and I've followed what's going on here, and it seems to me pretty clear that if there were a funding source that would just be fund disaster preparation and disaster response, we'd all be for it. But it's presented to us with this blackmail that if you accept that your first responders need that kind of training, to accept that kind of training, you also have to accept the militarization of your police force. I think it's important that we stand up and say, we don't accept that deal. That's not a deal that is fair to the people of Berkeley or to the people of this country. Thanks very much. Thank you.
How's it going? My name is Miguel Valencia. I'm a member of your district, District 2, Chair of the Vida. So fundamentally, I just want to say that I support the Urban Shield Subcommittee's motion to end Berkeley's, or to modify Berkeley's participation in 2018. And I think one issue that I think is difficult to grapple with, even myself, when understanding Urban Shield is, when a disaster happens, there is an increased possibility for a lot of harm to happen, and how can we actually handle that harm? And so it's difficult to envision alternatives, but I want to give one possibility, which is that this last Saturday I participated in a transformative justice training that's going to last for 6 weeks over the summer. Everyone is participating, there are about 50 people participating, and the wait list is long, so you're going to have more trainings after this one. But 50 people decided to take six Saturdays in the summer away to do this transformative justice training, which is specifically an alternative to punitive justice, where they try to, instead of finding justice and healing through further harm, they try to develop alternatives. It's not something I know a lot about. It's not something anybody in the training knows a lot about, but it's something that we all want to know about. So I'd love hearing that we were going to pull Berkeley Police out of Urban Shield, and I'd love some other members of the community talked about envisioning alternative ways to make a community safer by ensuring that citizens have water, ensuring that citizens have earthquake kits, possibly ensuring that citizens, making more opportunities for citizens to have this sort of training. One other point about the training, the transformative justice training, is that it's all run by volunteers, so it could really use a lot of that sort of training, needs a lot of support. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jenny Wank. I'm a CERT volunteer. I'm a neighborhood coordinator for an emergency preparedness group. I'm a member of the city's personnel board, and I'm a very long time, that's for District 1, but I'm a longtime resident of District 6. I would like to ask this audience a question. How many people in this room have taken any CERT class at all? This is unusual. Now, would you know, please notice how many of them have gray hair. If the Osaka quake has happened in this city or under the Warren Freeway today, your command post, your incident command centers would be staffed by people with hair that looks like this. We are the best trained people in the city for emergency response. And many of us have physical difficulties. Councilmember Davila, I don't know if you know it, but in a quake, all city resources, police and fire, will first concentrate here in downtown. Yo-yo, you're a yo-yo district. You're on your own. That's why we train. That's why we need to help.
So if we can just please direct our comments to the committee as a body.
Okay. But I'm not sure that she knew that this is a very real fact of life for most council districts in the city are yo-yo. And most residents don't want to admit it. They don't want to know it. They don't want to stop water. They don't want to stop food. They don't want to go to classes. So the idea that you're going to prepare everybody, not going to happen. And I'm not a fan of the current county sheriff. I miss Sheriff Plummer a lot. But I would like to see you work with other cities, other counties, to change Urban Shield from the inside. Standing on the outside throwing rocks has never worked. And so please do everything you can to change it, but change it from the inside so that we have the best possible training and best muscle memory in this city.
I have a question, ma'am. What do you mean by a yo-yo?
You're on your own.
Ah.
And members of the Berkeley Fire Department who deployed to Houston and Florida after those hurricanes told a CERT volunteer meeting to prepare for 2 weeks. Have enough water, have enough food, and be ready to shelter in place or evacuate for 2 weeks.
Is that true of the entire city, not just the poor districts?
It's true of everyone.
Thank you.
Because we can't predict what's going to happen where.
Well, that was one of the most racist things I've seen in a while in here, so that really bothers me. My name is Dr. James McFadden, and I'm here to support withdrawal of police participation in Urban Shield. In a recent article in Berkeley Side, one of the council members stated the following about Urban Shield. When you get this training, you build an immunity to horrific situations so that you can respond very quickly without thinking. Which is exactly the problem created by programs like Urban Shield, programming officers to act violently without thinking. This is why so many people, primarily people of color, are shot dead so quickly by police, because the police acted without thinking, because they reacted without thinking, generally in a state of fear. We don't want that kind of training here. What we need is conditioning and de-escalation, not conditioning and unrealistic terrorist scenarios. The general problem with Urban Shield training for terrorist attacks or general SWAT team training for that is that it breeds fear and a mindset open to the Hobbesian trap. And if you don't know what that is, Hobbesian trap explains why preemptive strikes occur between two groups out of bilateral fear of an imminent attack. Using militarized police equipment changes the psychology and perceptions of police and affects how they react in a confrontation. The primary police training at Urban Shield involves developing terrorist escalation, basically for a non-existent threat, because we're not a financial or military center. We're not the target of international terrorism. The only terrorism we experience is of the homegrown white supremacist variety egged on by our current president. As author and New York Times reporter James Risen observed, the Homeland Security Industrial Complex has been a windfall for Washington. Politicians have earned their learned that keeping the terrorist threat alive provides enormous political benefits. A decade of fear-mongering has brought power and wealth to those who have the most skill at hyping the terrorism threat. And the financial well-being of countless federal bureaucrats depends on this.
Thank you.
Eric Fromm, who some of you may have heard of, asked the question, is the fear of freedom at the root of the 20th century's predilection for one or another kind of totalitarianism? He then answered with the rise of democracy, while setting us free, also created a society where we feel isolated from our fellows, where relationships are impersonal, where insecurity replaces a sense of belonging. And this sense of isolation drives a man to a devotion and submission to an all-powerful organization from the state. And it appears that minor crises, like a handful of white supremacists showing up, can create that fear and submission to the state, or submission to police requests for more power and weapons. However, it is difficult to maintain that fear in light of how puny that threat really was. My greater fear was the overreaction of the militarized police to the Berkeley Against Hate peaceful protest and rally. People organizing in a democratic and peaceful fashion appear to be viewed as a threat to police order. It is a slow process to create that fear in the public, and Urban Shield in UIC and things like that really catalyzing that.
this is all going on. What we really need to do is understand what's going on behind the curtain. Don't listen to that all-powerful orange menace, the wizard, who keeps using smoke and mirrors. Look behind the curtain and recognize the manipulation. Recognize that the most, and also recognize that the most manipulated people in these scenarios are those in uniform. Their indoctrination is deep, conditioning and demanding our obedience with knowledge of their own impunity. Deeper conditioning than any of you have experienced. They are not the experts of what's needed regarding policy. This is your job. Please, make the decision.
It's 4 minutes, thank you.
Hi, my name is Khadija McFall, and I was involved with CERT from early in 2013 to 2015. I completed all the CERT courses that were available during that time, including the CERT Academy. I participated in the planning committee for the earthquake fair that was held at North Berkeley BART station, and I have a letter thanking me for that from former Fire Department Chief Gail Gong. I repeatedly beg to change this policy so that we wouldn't all have white-haired people who are available for emergencies. I said, why don't we provide childcare? That's how you get younger people to participate in things. They're probably working two or three or four jobs. They have kids. How do you expect them to get this? They care about their children. I also repeatedly tried to change the image of what we were presenting to the public to something other than what looked like suburban white people. And I was told, that's not cool, Khadija, and I quote, and I already distributed to you a flyer that was rejected for the 2014 earthquake exercise. Regrettably, I have to say, I think CERT is very permeated with white supremacist racism. I would like to change that. I totally value the experience I got through taking the CERT Academy. But I don't feel that that kind of thing is okay if what is incorporated in that is the idea that the winners are always supposed to be white people. You look at the FEMA videos. I know I haven't been out seen the ones recently, but if you look at the ones that are online, and these were the training videos that they showed us, they're all suburban white people. Give me a break.
I've just sent a message to Farina Fikes Brown and other people in the city of Berkeley, including people who are attending this meeting, regarding the June 18, 2018 quorum of Berkeley City Council at Urban Shield Council Subcommittee meeting. To whom it may concern, please find attached a photograph of the current B5 Berkeley City Council member who is attending above reference meeting. I am informed and believe that the aforementioned D5 council member is actively participating in the aforementioned meeting. All the said D5 council member is sitting in the back row of seats in the Berkeley City Council chambers on the second floor of Old City Hall. I have already reported this matter to the city clerk for the city of Berkeley. I do not appreciate anyone who violates the Brown Act. I do not appreciate anyone who violates my civil rights. I do not appreciate that we have a council member sitting in the back row of this meeting who has actively basically told people that I should not be on the homeless commission of all things. I do not understand why we have such political violence in this town. I do not understand why anyone would violate the process of public meetings. I do not appreciate the passive participation of a fifth council member at this meeting without notifying the public. That is not fair, that is not legal. That council member has a law degree and a law license in New York, and that council member is quite wealthy. I am not appreciative of the fact that we do not have an active democracy in this city. I am tired of people trying to pit the police against the citizens, because the police are vital to this community. And I would like to ask a question at some point. How is Urban Shield preventing Michael Dwayne Williams and my landlord from threatening my life on a regular basis? The violence against tenants in the city is appalling, and the fact we cannot even have a public meeting that is ethical without a fifth council person attending the meeting, although she's not saying anything right now. This is not part of due process. I would appreciate if we could try to have the Brown Act publicly posted on the walls of this room, in the hallway and perhaps hand-delivered to the fifth council person who's here today.
Thank you. Any other public comment?
Go ahead. No, I wanted to be honest.
Hi, J.P. Matsuri, District 4. My colleague Cindy told you about the petition. We've gathered almost 1,000 signatures, so let there be no doubt that the public in this community supports what you are recommending to the City Council, despite what you may be reading and getting from God knows where. Speaking of the petition, I mean, people have said everything I wanted to say, so I just thought I'd read some of the comments from people who have left comments on our petition. I agree with the petition 100%. I'm against the ongoing militarization of my local police force. I think mental health training and cultural training should be prioritized for the police, not military weapons. I want our police and city to be safe, but I don't think military solutions are right for our city. We don't need militarized police. We need peace officers. More weapons is not the answer. We are a sanctuary city, and the militarization of the police goes against our values as a city that embraces inclusion, progress, and peace. This is ridiculous. Police armed and looking like stormtroopers. I thought police were peace officers. I know our community is better off with resources divested from police and funneled to local needy citizens. So those are just a few comments. I have a ton of comments. I have a ton of petitions from all over the city, from every zip code. I thank you for the recommendation and hope that the full City Council does what you suggest. Thank you.
I've attended a lot of these ad hoc meetings only for one reason, and that is to save people's lives. That is my only reason. I participate in Urban Shield by Alameda County EMS, and I participated in Berkeley CERT, many scenarios outside of that, airport, earthquake, fire, you name it, in my spare time. I do a lot of volunteering. Anyway, I find it a little problemsome that a lot of the folks here today giving their opinion about the training for the Berkeley police don't have the background that they do. And I find it problematic that we're making judgments on what kind of training they need. And in mass casualties, there is an expected amount of deaths that are going to occur. And in my opinion, my little opinion, I think that they could use the tactical training in Urban Shield. And in addition to that, all the different trainings that they participate in. It's just a therapy, just like my kidney transplant. It's just a therapy to the problem. It's not going to solve it. But at the end of the day, when there is a mass casualty, I'm sure all of us would want our officers to have maximized training. And in my experience with all the different trainings that I volunteered for, including my family, Urban Shield is one of the best trainings, it's the biggest trainings, and for these types of scenarios, they need it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Schwartz, I had a question. So you participated in the Community Preparedness Fair and the CERT training. Have you participated in the other parts of Urban Shield?
So I have participated in many aspects of the Urban Shield, including a bombing, and I also was a wrangler bringing people to their scenarios. I saw bunches of volunteers, not 1 to 2K like the task force report says, but there's like 5,000 volunteers that actually participate.
You weren't able to attend the tactical exercises, is that right?
I actually did see part of that, yes.
Okay,
thank you.
Hi, I feel woefully unprepared. I'm glad to be here. I guess in a way I am kind of prepared. I participated in a sort of program for 15 years, if not more. Grew up in Berkeley, saw the People Park riot, got tear gas. It's been interesting living here, that's for sure. I'm also a search and rescue volunteer. I've been doing that for a couple years now. And I think participated in Berkeley Police Department active shooter drills. One at Berkeley High. I attended Berkeley High. My wife attended Berkeley High, so is my daughter. That was pretty moving to actually be at Berkeley High, the school I attended, the school my daughter attended. And to think that could be a real life scenario, especially in today's world, is frightening. And glad I'm not a parent of a high school student now, or, you know, who knows, it could happen anywhere. What I know about these skills is that they're perishable. These search and rescue skills, these search skills are very perishable, and if you're not practicing them, you lose them. It seems to me that Urban Shield provides an environment where you can really maybe do these skills in a real scenario where you might actually be able to benefit from that, and should a real scenario occur. I've gotten in and out of helicopters on one weekend. If I had to do it again, I might not be quite as smooth at it, but I know that having had that training will help me if I do. If I go to a conference, if I get sent to a conference, I'm kind of expected by my management to do certain things. I feel that if we look at Urban Shield as a training ground, a conference for the police department, that perhaps their management would direct them in the appropriate directions. And I can't believe I'm saying this, but maybe we have to trust them to take care of the police themselves and do what they need to do. Thank you.
I want to apologize for the macroaggressions earlier. That was really unfortunate. I feel like the folks that spoke about how awful Urban Shield is already said what I needed to say, but something I did want to talk about is actually this meeting and how it was canceled before, and the folks that can be here today and why we can be here today, and people that can't be here today and why those folks can't be here today. I think that it's largely, in my experience, the folks that I know, and my understanding is mostly retired folks. Seems very white, seems very, I think it's clearly even just by looking at us, some of our identities are clear. And I think I know a lot of people that would really like to have been here and speak against Urban Shield, but cannot because they are working class folks. I just wanted to share that. Also, I wanted to share POOR magazine, P-O-O-R magazine, as a resource. There was a person here earlier, I think the name was Miguel, but I might be making that up, that was really encouraging about alternatives for police. And I wanted to offer POOR magazine as a resource for those of you that are interested in looking into more alternatives to police. Because I think oftentimes the conversation ends at like those of us who are anti-police or anti-militarization of our police and are well versed in the history of our police and how they came to be as police patrol. And then the conversation ends there about like what could it look like then. And I think POOR magazine has a lot to offer in that regard. Thanks.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Lou Williams, longtime Berkeley resident, and I want to correct something that might have been said about CERT training being included. In other words, the
committee's recommendation to not do away with search training. I thought maybe I heard otherwise. You know, and of course we appreciate, you know, the work of our officers protecting the city. And we want them to get all the training they need. The problem is, what kind of training and who is the recipient of this training? I unfortunately was the recipient of a police strike on my head a year ago at Longfellow School. Maybe some of you remember that incident. And I think that incident demonstrated the problem with police doctrine in the city. When the city takes training, and has been said before, that sees the citizens, that conceives of the citizens as the enemy, as somebody that needs to be mobilized against, as somebody that, you know, we need to be, the city, the police need to be armed against and have weapons and doctrine, that is not the kind of city we need to live in. Berkeley is going to have demonstrations now forever because we oppose a lot of the stuff happening. I think for the police, are you on our side? Which you should be living in the city? Or are you on the side of repressive forces? Using repressive doctrine, repressive tactics, repressive weaponry, put down the people of Berkeley who are screaming in pain at what is going on in the world. I direct that question to the police and the council. Get rid of it. Some parts can be saved, but otherwise it doesn't fit with the Berkeley that I want to live in. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other public comment? Thank you all for joining us this afternoon and for your comments. We're now going to move to item 3, approval of the minutes of our meeting of June 4, 2018.
I just wanted to comment about from what I referred to as a racist comments by that woman and not being, and her being able to direct her comments at me before and not being stopped. That was just like so inappropriate, so unnecessary. And I just have to, it's just irritating. And that's part of what Urban Shield is. And that's the reason why she's able to think she's in, can say that to, I'm a vice mayor now for a short period of time, but to a council person. I just thought that was just really inappropriate and felt that I wasn't being supported. And I just wanted to say that because it was really wrong.
Councilmember Wayne.
Yes, on the minutes. I wanted to make some corrections to the next time. Number 4, discuss recommendations from Fire and Disaster Safety Commission. The pages aren't numbered, so
it's page 2.
It's page 2. There's I mentioned that Councilmember Wainwright feels it's appropriate to tell the police department, inappropriate to tell the police department they cannot attend the vendor show. And I believe it was at that point that Sergeant Bombi clarified that the vendor show attendance is integral to the tactical exercise. So I'd like that added to the minutes. And on page 3, council member expressed that Urban Shield is an important opportunity to offer officers given the staffing crisis BP faces, and the thrust of my comment, and I believe I said it, was that there are ramifications that are not being considered in this decision. Okay. So I'd like to add it as well. Thank you.
Just a correction as well on last page summarizing the motion that was adopted by a majority of the committee. It was moved by Harrison, and I believe I did second the motion. So if we can just correct that to reflect it's Councilmember Harrison's motion, and I second the motion. So I move adoption of the minutes with the changes that were described.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on the motion? Is there any objection to the motion? Seeing no objection, motion carries, minutes are approved. Thank you, Tana, for all your work in transcribing the discussion. Councilmember?
Sorry, I have one more correction.
Okay, so let's rescind the vote.
Okay. Sorry.
Make sure you get all your corrections in now.
Yeah, the problem is I have two sets of minutes because we changed the meeting. So, at the bottom of page 3, I think there's some kind of typo there. It says, lack of de-escalation are all examples of things that are not example. I'm not sure exactly what the intent there was, but I don't think that's correct.
Example of things, the chief had asked what we found problematic, and that was my response. So it's a lack of all the other things and a lack of de-escalation, all examples of things that we find problematic and the community finds problematic in Urban Shield.
Okay.
Did
you get that?
Okay, I'm writing it down. Anything else? This is your last chance.
I know.
Okay. All right. I move adoption of minutes with those corrections. Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Is there any objection to the motion? Hearing no objection, the minutes are approved. And once again, thank you, Tana, for all your work in transcribing the discussion and preparing these minutes. We really appreciate it. So we'll now go to item number 4, discussion and action on the letter that was referred to us from Councilmember Worthington to the Bay Area Urban Area Security Initiative. On June 20th, when the council formed a subcommittee, we were directed to review the proposed letter from Councilmember Worthington, which I believe is included in the packet, which is directed to the Urban Area Security Initiative. Since that time, the Alameda County Board of Supervisors has voted to say that they will no longer fund Urban Shield as presently constituted. And so I think one question we should discuss is, would this letter better be directed to Sheriff Gregory Ahern? I think it would, and the Alameda County Board of Supervisors. And I think given the discussion that's happening, not only here in the city of Berkeley, but also at the county level, I think many of the issues that Councilmember Worthington raises are things that we should communicate to Alameda County in its consideration of future changes to the Urban Shield program. So I think maybe shifting the focus to Alameda County, practical sense, Councilmember Harrison.
Yeah, I think also we want to direct part of this to BRUOC that has to do with putting more focus on community preparedness in their guidelines, and then asking the sheriff and the Board of Supervisors to do all the other things that are indicated here.
Okay. Councilmember Winger.
Yeah, I'm just wondering if we should hold this till our later discussion.
The next item is on the future of Urban Shield. So that
we send a unified and integrated message.
Okay.
Because this is coming from the council, and if we later decide that something else is supposed to come from the council, I'm just thinking we may want to incorporate this, but I'm just concerned about voting on this separate from some action we may be taking later on in the discussion.
So the next item, item 5, is discussion on the future program. And I think whatever recommendations we may make to the City Council on that issue could be reflected in this letter. So what is the committee's prerogative? Should we maybe go to the next item and then take this up after?
Yeah, I think that's a good suggestion.
Councilmember Dowdle?
There's some edits to this letter that should be made, though, I think. So we can take that up after? Or?
Yeah, why don't we take it? Why don't we go to item 5 now, then we can go back to item 4, if that's okay? Okay, so we're going to go to item 5, discussion and action on a recommendation on emergency preparedness preparation in Alameda County beyond 2018. This item is intended to enable discussion on the future of the Urban Shield program in Alameda County and a recommendation to the City Council on that issue. And we've had several discussions at previous meetings about that. And I think I have some notes I want to go through around that to summarize some of the concerns that we've heard from the community around the current design of the program, elements that should be included in the future program. We've heard specific requests from our chief of police around what should be in the program. So I think we need to discuss, you know, what specific recommendations we want to make to Alameda County. Councilmember McGrath?
Yeah. I don't know if this is the appropriate time to raise it, but I have some process questions that have never really been discussed. So, for example, we've never really talked about what form our recommendations going forward are going to take. We've never talked about, you know, we have a very
The report is item number 7.
I know.
So I'd like for you to hold your comments on that until that time.
Okay. So if I just want to understand what the process is because I
sure.
feel
I can explain what we've done with other subcommittees.
Okay.
So just like a council member submits a report to the City Council, this would be in the form of an action item, using the regular report format to the Berkeley City Council. To summarize any recommendations that the subcommittee explicitly makes. So that would be the format.
Using the internal process. As a subcommittee, how do we work?
If there is a recommendation that is made by a majority of the subcommittee, just like with the Open Government Subcommittee or other council subcommittees, that will be reported to the City Council. Now, however, there were several questions, and I did pass out to the committee members. There were, starts on page 4, there's a long list of issues and questions that the council asked us to look into and to respond to. And so whatever we send to council, we have to respond to those questions. We were specifically charged with having to respond explicitly to these questions. So at the very least, we have to explain to council what is our analysis and response to these particular issues that were referred to us.
Yeah.
That's one thing.
Right. I also would point out that on page 2, a very specific question to that nigger,
yes.
which we were also tasked with responding to.
Yes.
So,
I know that you have an item on the agenda, which we'll get to later, with regard to whether we should request the council extend this committee. I would prefer that we try to reach resolution this afternoon. I think we've had over a year of discussion and we made a recommendation on NCRIC, which was to continue participation, but to request that the city enter into a formal memorandum of understanding with NCRIC. And we can work on, based on all the discussion information we received, answering these particular questions. If you'd like, my office can work on sort of writing up a response to these particular questions and then sending it around to the subcommittee members to get your input. I don't think that requires that we have a meeting. We're working on the report because we've had a lot of conversation. We have minutes, we have materials that we received. We take all that and just sort of map out how they respond to issues. So, Tom, I apologize, but I think we can take the lead, and if any other council offices want to assist, in working to respond through these questions so that we have that written response that we're going to provide to council.
I would just request that it be an inclusive process.
Absolutely.
And that all members of the subcommittee be included.
I absolutely agree, and I will ensure that that is the case. So any other questions? So we are on, the item that we are on is item 5, which is the recommendation on future of Urban Shield. And I guess I'll start by saying that there's a number of areas that I think we may want to discuss. So first, there are clear benefits that have been articulated by our police department, fire department. There are elements of the program that we have gained enormous benefit from. And specifically with regard to our police department, the ability to work with other first responders, with EMT, with fire departments, in terms of responding to critical incidents, the leadership development, the preparation for real-life scenarios, as well as learning about particular emergency response techniques that we have applied in the city of Berkeley. Those are all things that we have heard that are benefits. And so, you know, I personally think it's important to acknowledge what are the benefits to the existing program. The challenges, and I personally think it's important to also acknowledge that I have not heard of any established negative outcome as a result of our police department's participation in Urban Shield. I've heard a great deal of concern about the sheriff, and the design of the program, and I think it's important that we direct our attention to how we can change the program or come up with a new program through the Alameda County process. I think many of the things that Councilman Worthington had described highlight some of the concerns. Sort of racist elements, not only in the vendor show, but also in the design of scenarios, and particularly, you know, attributing towards people's motivations or beliefs or backgrounds. That's a concern. In addition, the presence of foreign military entities in designing the scenarios and participation in those scenarios. One concern is what is the role of Berkeley and our police department in having a role in really shaping the program? I think that's important if we're going to participate. I think other law enforcement agencies should have a voice and a role in that process. We have heard concerns about the emphasis. It's been principally on sort of responding to terrorism and not enough on actual types of situations that we may anticipate in the region. And that just doesn't include emergency response, but, you know, real life scenarios that may impact the safety of our residents. So really thinking about how we can design a program that responds to the actual types of incidents that we will have to respond to in this region. That doesn't mean that, you know, shootings are not part of that. So, you know, what is our role in the process, transparency around the program, the involvement of foreign military entities whose human rights records may be totally contrary to our values and the laws of our country. The sort of racist elements that have been referenced in the expo in the past, as well as in the actual scenarios themselves. Those are all things that I've heard. And there's also a question around the guidelines that Alameda County had developed, which I think are things that we absolutely should sort of build upon, those guidelines. So that's just sort of a summary of the things I've heard from the community, as well as the things I've heard, the benefits I've heard from our police department. Councilmember Wenger.
Yeah. Well, I think that we all agree on those issues. I don't think anybody here disagrees. But I want to point out that in the packet of the Alameda County Supervisors meeting on Urban Shield, there is a memo from Sheriff Ahern dated March 5th, 2018. So just a little bit ago. And I want to read it out loud into the record. As a response to community concerns expressed to members of the Board of Supervisors, the Sheriff's Office has established the following principles and guidelines. And I read these because I think they're very much in sync with what we as a subcommittee want to see happen in Urban Shield. One, expand community involvement and awareness. Two, Urban Shield will be free from racist stereotyping. Three, work to expand training the medical profession for critical incidents. Four, Urban Shield will not include surveillance training. Five, continue to examine new technology and equipment. Six, Urban Shield will not include crowd control training. Seven, continue to evaluate existing equipment. Eight, Urban Shield will exclude any and all vendors who display derogatory or racist messages in any form. I don't remember the number I'm up to.
Nine.
Ten?
No, nine.
Nine. Urban Shield will exclude the sale or transfer of any assault weapons and firearms. 11, will exclude vendors displaying non-law enforcement related tactical uniforms and equipment. 12, Urban Shield will strive to maintain the finest first responder training possible. And the last one, that no invitations to participate in Urban Shield be extended to teams from countries with documented human rights violations. Now, these are very broad principles. I think they're very good principles. And this is signed by Sheriff Ahern, dated May 5th, 2018. Now, I understand that there is a lot of skepticism about Sheriff Ahern adhering to these principles. I think it's our job to be vigilant, and it's our job to monitor what is happening at Urban Shield. We have come a long way. Sheriff Ahern has signed these 14 guidelines and principles that I believe everybody in this room can agree on. So I feel that we can incorporate these guidelines that Sheriff Ahern has agreed to publicly. This is a matter of public record. And use them in what we come up with as our recommendation. And some of them are very similar to Councilmember Worthington's. Some of them go beyond what Councilmember Worthington was suggesting. So.
Councilmember Harrison.
Thank you for that. I think that's very helpful as a starting point. I wanted to follow up on both of your comments. I do believe that we did hear of some of the benefits of Urban Shield, and I was struck particularly with the benefit of the leadership opportunities that it gives to our officers to work in very stressful situations, and that is of help. In terms of the issue of coordination with other departments, I don't think that is clear, because our police department, participates in the tactical exercises on their own. What we're hoping for, and one thing I'd like to add to this list, is that there be more integration of police, fire, public health and other entities together in the training. Because in real life, that's how it happens. Everyone appears together. What I see is an isolated training for police and then an isolated training for the fire department. We know that this year's Yellow Command, which the fire department will participate in, is going to focus on mass casualty. If the police, if this recommendation is not adopted by the full council for this current year, I would hope the police would agree to attend that. There's nothing keeping them from attending Yellow Command that involves coordination with other departments, because I think that's one of the possible strengths, but it's not in evidence at Urban Shield the way it exists now. So that would be a condition for me. Also, I want to say something about the idea of real-life scenarios. I believe the exercises, the tactical exercises, focus pretty significantly, all but two last year, on large-scale international terrorism. I'm not denying the possibility of terrorism, but the terrorism we likely face here is homegrown and often white supremacist terrorism, the use of guns, driving over people with vans and cars. This does not work towards that very actively. Many of the terrorist events are international terrorist events replicated here, some from Pakistan, some from Hezbollah, et cetera. And that's part of the reason why I have concerns with the involvement of international teams, is it's the wrong focus. To the extent that we have terrorism, we should be focused on local actors. And I really feel for the police department, this increase in armaments in the world must be incredibly scary for you. And I can only feel what that must feel like. So I'd like to see that, if there's a focus at all on terrorism, be more about this local piece of terrorism, what we really see happening. A more emphasis on de-escalation, emphasis on what's known as dual use. Dual use is a category that allows you to say it has a connection to terrorism, but it's also useful in the case of fire or earthquakes. San Francisco has done a lot of work to make sure that their training programs fit the dual use definition. They're not just training for terrorism. They're training for responding to an incident. Whether that building was blown up by a fire, a gas leak, or a terrorist, their response is somewhat the same. So I would ask that these exercises be recast to the response, the result of an event, and not so focused on the actors that created the event. I think that's one of the main problems. Also, I continue to have problems with the involvement of vendors at all who come from the military-industrial complex and the prison industry. I know that he says that he will isolate them. I don't know why they're there, except because they help pay for the vendor show. So I'm concerned about that. And finally, I just have to say I am somewhat cynical about this, because the board last year asked that there be no participation by groups such as ICE, and ICE, in fact, participated after that statement was made by the board. The board asked that there be no racism, and we see examples in the kinds of exercises where the victims continue to be more Caucasian and the perpetrators of other colors. And the board asked there be no evidence of surveillance technology, which clearly appeared because Gemalto, the face recognition surveillance technology firm, was at the vendor show. So these promises have been made before and broken. I would be interested in finding out how we can make these concrete, that these are not breakable, and that some of the other conditions I mentioned were included. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor Dow.
Yeah, so Councilmember Harrison made some of the points that I wanted to make, but one of the things that this doesn't include, for one, it always is a nexus on terrorism, which needs to be eliminated, I feel, but it also doesn't include any preparedness for nuclear, bioterrorism, chemical, or so those are the things, or like the pipeline breaking or exploding, which is a big issue for Berkeley. And it doesn't have enough participation from citizens. Citizens need to be more trained in all of these things, because really they are going to be the first responders. And the nexus to terrorism needs to be eliminated, and the enemy combatants. We are not enemies, we are citizens. That needs to be eliminated, period. Because that's.
I'm sorry, I'm not following. What are you looking at? What document are you looking at?
I'm not looking at a document. It's just part of the. That's just.
When you say eliminated, eliminated from what?
From the whole idea of citizens being the enemy. And having a nexus to terrorism, because we are not terrorists, we are citizens. So we should not be, the training should not be in that context. Period. Also, so like it's not dealing with anything to do with climate change. You know, the unhoused people. I mean, these are the things that we need to be dealing with. We need to learn how to get prepared for, you know, 150 degrees in Berkeley, or 120, or 115. You know, we're not even looking at anything like that. So those are the, Urban Shield isn't looking at these kinds of things that are really gonna impact Berkeley. We don't need to have the, like you said, the other countries coming that don't have, that have human rights violations. We don't need to be participating in a training with them, period. And with the other, the Great Command, which is the Community Preparedness Fair, what was there? The Oath Keepers. What else was there? The junior Marines. What else was there? The junior Alameda County Sheriffs. So what else are they doing? They're militarizing our children. That's a big problem for me. And I don't think, I mean, I understand that these, the gray, the yellow, and the green, but it's still, to me, part of the whole. I understand that I voted to participate in that, but I'm just saying, these are other issues that should be addressed with the sheriff. Although these little Alameda County sheriffs are part of his department, and so are the junior Marines, I believe. But, you know, well, that's just a problem for me, the militarization of the children as well as the police. And it's also, we need to have clear goals for training the police department. And understand what skills are desired, and the gaps in the skills, and the strengths and the weaknesses. We also need a clear training list that the police department participates in on an annual and a five-year basis, including skills gains, the costs, and the hours spent. Urban Shield is not a training, it's a practice. It's a time for practice. It's an opportunity to express skills developed through other trainings in the form of a competition. So maybe we need to eliminate the competition aspect of Urban Shield, because why? Also, the CPE report was proposed in ways to address racial bias and implied biases. So maybe we need to have some more implicit bias training and more de-escalation, and so that they can recognize those types of incidences when they occur. We should be supporting interventions in mental health incidences towards de-escalation rather than criminalization or collateral damage. So we need to update the police training that supports those interventions. Community resilience and civilization of emergency response. Berkeley needs to focus on disasters we're most likely to face. Natural disasters, climate change, houselessness, live shooters, and threats from white supremacists and nationalists. Those are the things that I think we should be expressing to Ahern. and to look at other countries and programs that aid in the face of a large-scale natural disaster like Haiti and Puerto Rico and Japan. We need to have those types of trainings. And I'll stop right there for right now. Thank you.
Councilmember Harrison.
I did forget one item on my list, which is I noticed that both in this letter and before the hearing of the Board of Supervisors, the sheriff did indicate he would seek more community involvement. But what is missing from that is also involvement by our local departments. We had a lot of discussion at the subcommittee meeting about trying to look at this perhaps sub-regionally, having groups of cities in different parts of Alameda County come together and decide what their interests were. Not necessarily involved in developing the exact scenarios, but involved in saying this is the kind of training we'd like to see. More local involvement in the planning of the event is an important piece for me.
Yeah.
Also, and then he did say in the letter to the board that he would agree that the board would be more involved in designing the event, but this letter does not say the board. So it's three things. It's the community, it's local departments, not us, the department, and the Board of Supervisors. The other thing that he mentioned at the hearing but did not include in his letter is that he would be interested in providing a sensitivity officer that would examine all content during the provision of the training. That does not appear here in his letter.
Yeah, that's what Supervisor Hagerty says.
Yes, exactly. And finally, there's nothing here about the exclusion of ICE. This is one of our biggest problems. He nowhere says he's going to exclude ICE, and ICE appeared at the community fair of all things. So I'm concerned about that as well. So I have kind of a lengthy list of things I'd like to see added to this. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to, after Councilmember Wingraff speaks, try to...
Okay, so I think those are very good suggestions. And what I'd like to, in the interest of time, it's a quarter after four already, what I'd like to try to do is see if we can agree to put together all of these points that would be incorporated in our recommendation to the City Council. So, do you have the, I don't know who has the list.
I've been taking notes somehow.
Okay, so maybe we can, so let's start with all of those things that are in the sheriff's letter.
Yes.
And then, I know that, and then we can go to maybe Councilmember Worthington's letter. He's very specific, and I think maybe too specific. He says one third of the time spent on Urban Shield trainings must focus on de-escalation. I think that it would behoove us to be more general and say more time on de-escalation tactics or training or exercises. De-escalation exercises, I think, is the best way to put it, since Urban Shield is exercise. I think the issue about stereotyping has already been dealt with. Let's see. Prioritizing trainings for specific national disasters and health concerns. I think, Councilmember Davila, that was one of your points.
Yeah.
And we could add in there, and for environmental concerns caused by climate change. Is that okay, Councilmember Davila?
Yeah, but we also need to deal with like the pipeline.
Okay, that's coming, okay. But I think we should separate out the climate change issue as a single issue. We could mention wildfires, gas explosions. These are all things we've witnessed in the last several years. So wildfires, gas explosions, what else have we had?
Flyers, choosing route.
Housing crisis.
Housing crisis.
Housing crisis, I don't see as a, I mean, it's a crisis, but I don't think it's a crisis that can be addressed at Urban Shield.
Yeah, the camps, because of the drought, there was large landslides that they had to deal with.
Landslides? Okay, landslides.
Floods.
Sounds like Passover. Sea level rise?
Biohazard? Biohazard?
Display excluding vendors with derogatory, racist, xenophobic messages. I think that's been covered in the sheriff's guidelines. Full transparency, I think that's a very good one. Require full transparency on what events staff take part in, and require community observers of all events and trainings. I think that's fine. So, and then add to that list your list, Kate. Jesse, you have them?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'd like to move that. Is there a second?
So let me just, motion is to recommend to the Berkeley City Council that we provide the following recommendations to the Alameda County Board of Supervisors and Alameda County Sheriff regarding the reconstitution of Urban Shield and providing tactical and emergency preparedness training for local law enforcement using the establish principles and guidelines for Urban Shield, in addition to all the issues that have, all the, I guess, recommendations that have been mentioned this afternoon by the subcommittee.
Do you want me to second it? Second.
And that, you know, that includes, for example, excluding ICE, sensitivity officer, community, local police, and board supervisors' involvement in planning, more integration of police, fire, public health, and EMT into scenarios, dual use, terrorism, as well as emergency preparedness, greater focus on local threats. I think including what the chief of police had mentioned in his letter, which is tactical scenario trainings based on real life incidents, is important. Is there any, would you have any objection to that, council member? Wingraff, can clear that?
Tactical training exercises based on real life.
Real life incidents.
Yeah.
Yeah, the chief had sent his letter, which he had sent, well, chief sent two letters. He sent a letter previously, as well as a letter this afternoon, that Urban Shield must involve tactical scenario trainings based on real life incidents in order to provide the highest level of training for our police department. And that this could be administered without attributing offenders' motivations or beliefs to the tactical teams. So I think we should include that clearly, as well as those issues in Councilman Worthington's letter that are not included. Councilmember Harrison?
Yes, the only thing that was missed in that list is that there'd be no involvement of vendors involved with military or prison industries. His earlier comments to the board where he would isolate them, I think they should not be involved in this. It's really what we're focused on is local law enforcement. The sheriff earlier indicated to the board of supervisors at the meeting that he would separate out the military and prison industry vendors. I'm recommending that we say we do not want to see any involvement with those vendors because they really don't relate to local law enforcement.
there's an item here that says we'll exclude vendors displaying non-law enforcement related tactical uniforms and equipment.
I'd be more comfortable with that, a little more explicit for me, because the problem is there's a difficulty with these firms that supply the military, and that's their primary purpose. They may have something law enforcement could use, but they're also displaying a lot of very heavy militarized weaponry. So I understand the concern about using the word militarization. It just sounds so weighted and doesn't mean anything, but this language doesn't exactly say what I'm trying to say. We want to exclude vendors that are whose primary focus is military, supplying the military and prisons, and focus on vendors who supply local law enforcement.
Can we put it in the positive?
Yes. Focus on vendors that supply local law enforcement as opposed to those who, yeah.
Thank you.
And then the other thing I was going to mention. Oh, now I've lost it. Sorry, hold on. No, I think we got it. Thank you.
Okay. So all that's in the motion.
It's he has will not include surveillance training. I think it should say or equipment at the vendor show. Because that's what the board asked for originally. It was no surveillance equipment.
I just want to clarify, Councilmember Harrison. So you were aware of these guidelines?
There was an interchange at the Board of Supervisors where verbally the sheriff mentioned a few things, not all of these, and some of them were more what he has said here. So I'd have to find that again, but he said to the board when they had their hearing that he would not, that he would involve the Board of Supervisors in training, and he doesn't say that in the letter. He said that he'd have the sensitivity officer, and he doesn't say that in the letter. So what I'm doing is taking what he says in the letter and what he said at the hearing, adding some of our concepts, adding some of Councilmember Worthy.
Okay. I wasn't at the hearing, so
right.
I,
no,
I don't know
hearing.
What's wrong.
And we also need, I don't know how to do this, we need some kind of accountability mechanism. I don't think we have to specify what that is, but some way of knowing that he's actually doing what he's promised.
I think didn't somebody recommend some monitoring? Didn't Supervisor Haggerty recommend some monitoring going on? I know that there's been an audit that's been requested of the Sheriff's Department. I know that for sure. So, and that's going to happen.
I don't see that in the part of the transcript that I have here, sorry, from Supervisor Haggerty. But yeah, there needs to be, I don't even know that we need to specify, we just need to say, please provide a mechanism for ensuring this, board.
Do you have a transcript of that meeting?
I listened to the entire transcript of the meeting. I listened to the entire board meeting.
But you don't have a printed copy?
I don't have a printed copy of printed parts, but thank you. But I can get it to you.
So, I think we're sort of articulating broad guidelines. And one thing that we sort of learned in a conversation with Supervisor Carson is that it seems unlikely that there's going to be an entirely new, different program. That what is likely to happen is that Urban Shield will continue to exist. It's a question of, will it exist as it is presently designed, or will there be changes to Urban Shield? So I know that there's been conversation in the past around, you know, doing some entirely different type of program. That would be ideal, but really a lot of it depends on WASI and changing the way that they define nexus to terrorism and the way that they allocate funding, and that's what seems most likely in the short term is that it may continue to rest with Sheriff Ader. And so how can we influence the county's process to work constructively to shape the design of the program? Councilman Longer?
So one thing I would like to suggest when we make our recommendations to council is that we participate in the, I think it's called the Public Protection Subcommittee. And I think that they're going to be putting out their agenda next week for their first meeting on this issue, and that we participate and we have some input into those meetings. And we also talked about actually meeting with Supervisor Valle and Haggerty, which we never did. And I think we might want to do that, but the subcommittee is sunsetting on Wednesday, so.
But we could.
We could do it as independent of the subcommittee. Yeah.
Okay. And then Councilor Harris, I know in the report at the end it talks about a task force. I would prefer that we not form a task force. I think we've put a great deal of time and energy into this process, and I think we should just put forward our recommendations and then work through the Board of Supervisors and the community to help influence the future program.
Yeah, I'm fine with that. I'm just trying to look for some formalized way for us to have input so we don't just send this recommendation to them and we never hear from them again. So we'll just have to figure, we can do that internally. It does not need to be a task force, but we need a mechanism of some kind to be involved. And you suggest one of going to the meetings of public protection, so that'd be fine. I don't think we need to.
I mean, you know, we've discussed meeting with members of the Board of Supervisors. Mm-hmm. There's a whole community effort going on right now to help try to influence the change of the program will be made. I'm certainly talking to other elected officials in Alameda County around this issue, and I think the broad principles that we establish could be a framework by which we can get other cities to sign on to and to help steer the conversation at the county level. So I think one of the positive aspects of this process has been not only learning a great deal about our police department and about these different programs, but learning a lot to inform what that future program could be and to help shape it meaningfully. So the motion is to recommend to the Berkeley City Council the following recommendations on guidelines on the reconstitution of the Urban Shield program, which include the principles and guidelines adopted by the Alameda County Sheriff, as well as the, I guess, amendments that we discussed this afternoon. Are we recording this, Tom? Okay, great. Okay. You know, which include most of the things that we discussed, excluding ICE participation, establishment of a sensitivity officer to ensure that there are no racist elements in our program and to ensure compliance with these guidelines, community, local police, and Board of Supervisors involvement in the planning of Urban Shield, focus on local terrorists and local threats, prioritize training exercises for specific natural disasters and health concerns that have a large impact on Berkeley and the Bay Area, including environmental concerns caused by climate change, wildfires, gas pipeline explosions, landslides, sea level rise, more time spent on de-escalation tactics, no international teams involved in planning or participating in the scenarios, more integration, police, fire, public health, and EMT, dual use of funding to focus on terrorism as well as emergency disaster response, correct? The suggestion from the chief of police that Urban Shield incorporate tactical scenario trainings based on real life incidents to be administered without attributing offenders' motivations or beliefs to the tactical teams. And just trying to see if there's anything else in the Worthington letter that we can, that's not already covered.
I think we missed one thing that I have.
They dedicate more WASI funding to prepare communities and cities as a whole to respond to emergencies in ways that give precedence to community readiness, disaster prevention, recovery and infrastructure development. I didn't see that in any of these. That's an OWASI recommendation. Yeah, so we should separate that out. That's correct. Require full transparency on what events staff take part in, and permit community observers at all events and trainings. I think that's good. Councilmember Harrison?
Yeah, the focus on the vendors on those that are specific to local law enforcement rather than to the military applications and prison applications.
Councilor Wenger, if you're the seconder.
I don't know enough about it. I guess it's okay to put in, I mean, as a recommendation. But I wouldn't know, I wouldn't know personally.
There's language around some of the vendors, things like this equipment is battle tested and military grade. So there's a concern that it's come from that orientation.
One of the things that I was going to suggest is that we provide the city council with, on the Urban Shield website, is a list of all of the vendors and what they are displaying at the fair. And I would suggest that we include that in the information that we send, because actually looking at it, there was weaponry, but there was an awful lot of other stuff too. And so I think, to be fair, let the council see exactly who signed up, and then they'll know.
I have another recommendation which I'll make after you've done this around the Homeland Security funding. And maybe there's something else we want to say to OWASI. So I think that's a motion with respect to the recommendations of Alameda County. Councilor Harrison.
Oh, I'm done. Thank you.
Councilor Dabble.
It doesn't state anything about biological, nuclear, radiological, incendiary, chemical, or explosive devices. None of that training occurs. I mean, we're not dealing with any of those types of
Well, in my district alone, I have two reservoirs. I have the north side of campus, including the computer science department and the journalism school, which has some very outspoken people in it. I have two campuses of a school that has been specifically the target of threats. And I really don't want to exclude any kind of exercises that might prohibit our force from getting training that might be applicable in situations that might affect those sites. The reservoir water supply a water supply is vulnerable. Let me just put it that way. A water supply is vulnerable. Our campuses are very vulnerable. Our Greek theater is vulnerable. There are all of these potential places that could become targets, and is it likely? I have no way these days of knowing or judging what the likelihood is. I feel like this kind of activity, this violence, is being emboldened by our administration in Washington. We're definitely seeing an increase in these kinds of attacks. I'm not saying they're going to come from foreign countries, but I think we really need to give our force as much exposure to exercises concerning these things as possible, and I just don't want to go too far in limiting it.
So, think there are kind of two elements. Oh, I'm sorry, you have the floor, Councilor Dowd.
I'm sorry, I don't think she understood what I was saying. I was saying we needed to add those things in, not take them out.
Thank you. I didn't understand it at all.
Yeah.
So, Councilor Dowd, could you describe?
So, this biological, it's listed on page 14 of the draft report. Biological, nuclear, radiological, incendiary, chemical, and explosive devices. Not addressed in any of the trainings, as far as I can tell.
Biological, nuclear, radiological, incendiary, mm-hmm. chemical, and explosive devices.
Yeah.
So we want to see trainings in those areas.
Correct.
Okay.
That's fine.
Good.
That's great. So there's really kind of, there's multiple elements that we're discussing that we think should be reflected. There's the tactical piece that is specifically designed to respond to real life incidents to make sure that our first responders have that training so that if there is a mass shooting that happens in the city of Berkeley, that they are prepared to respond to that. So that's one piece, and I absolutely agree with Chief Green what that needs to be explicitly part of our recommendation. We cannot completely exclude that. That has to be a piece of it. At the same time, however, there needs to be other elements that need to be emphasized, including responding to these other types of threats that are more likely to happen in our region. You know, natural disasters, biological threats. That piece also, and how police, the sheriff, and other first responders respond in a coordinated fashion to those types of threats, I think is another component that needs to be emphasized, as well as the community. What role does the community play working with our first responders to respond to earthquakes, fires, you know, floods, as well as other real threats to the safety of our community? So those are the different elements that I am hearing that we want to be considered as not principally tactical, but that there are other elements that we believe will add value towards keeping our community safe and resilient. Councilmember Winger? Councilmember Dowell?
I just also want to bring attention to this nice little graph that was handed out, because this is a survey of almost 300 people, and most of them, their main concern was de-escalation, sensitivity to cultural differences, hate crimes, protection, and domestic violence. So all these things that are at the top that should be a part of the training as well.
That'd be difficult to do in this context. I feel like we need to spend more local money on these things.
And we're doing a lot of this already. I mean, I think it's important to acknowledge. We have a mission team, and we provided every police officer crisis intervention training, although we need to increase staffing so we have a crisis intervention team. We have Sergeant Bombi is an expert on de-escalation, and our department's undergone extensive de-escalation training as we've learned through this process. There's all sorts of types of sensitivity training that our department provides as well. So I think these are things that we are currently already doing, and I think what Urban Shield and the funding is specifically for is how we respond to threats. Threats to terrorist threats, threats to public safety. I think these are all very valid issues, and I think these are things that we're already training we're already providing to our police department. So there's a motion. And I think we summarized a lot of the key elements of it. And transcribe it after this meeting. So this is about a recommendation to Alameda County on the reconstitution of Urban Shield. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Are there any abstentions? Okay. I vote aye. So the Motion passes 3-2-0-1 to the Berkeley City Council. I'd like to make a motion, and this is around the funding, federal funding for non-terrorism preparedness activities, that we recommend to the Berkeley City Council, that we recommend to our members of Congress to expand federal Homeland Security grants to fund non-terrorism preparedness activities.
Second.
Okay. Discussion on the motion? Yes, Councilor Dowd?
I have a question on the draft report on page 19.
We're not on the report yet.
Oh, okay.
I'm just making a motion, which is that we recommend to the City Council that the Council requests that our members of Congress broaden, expand federal Homeland Security grants to fund non-terrorism preparedness activities. That's the motion. Okay, any, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, I'm sorry, Councilor Dale. I mean, Councilor Winger.
Yeah, I'm thinking that there may be a more positive way to present this. That instead of saying to fund non-terrorism preparedness activities, that you strike non-terrorism and put in disaster preparedness activities.
I think that reflects what you were recommending,
Councilor
Harrison.
Yes, that's fine.
That's fine. So I'll amend the motion to include that.
Thank you.
Is that acceptable, Councilmember Harrison? Okay, that's the motion. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Motion carries unanimously. And then there was there were a couple things around WASI, right, that we wanted to... Yeah, that was not part of our charge. That's true. Should we go to Chris's letter now?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go to item... and I think I just made a whole series of recommendations on guidelines. Should this letter be modified to be directed to the sheriff and to reflect those guidelines, or should this be directed to the Urban Air Security Initiative? Councilmember Wingraff? Oh, Councilor Harrison, please.
I think it should be directed to the Board of Supervisors and CCing the sheriff and UASI.
I agree.
Councilmember Winker.
Yeah, so a lot has happened since this letter was drafted. Mm-hmm. And I'm thinking that perhaps whatever we send up to council should be sent in the form of a letter to Alameda County. So I'm thinking that maybe this letter doesn't need to go. That it would be supplanted by the recommendation that we send to council.
Yeah, I think that was actually what I was suggesting, which is that rather than forwarding this letter, which was directed to the Urban Air Security Initiative, to have them kind of ship the money to put guidelines on the money that they're allocating to Urban Shield, where there's a whole new conversation happening now. And so
Right. The
letter should be to Alameda County and should specifically recommend the guidelines that we had just outlined. So
I guess what I'm suggesting is that we don't take action on Councilmember Worthington's letter, and that we have the our recommendations to council be sent to Alameda County.
Right. With a CC
to whoever you want.
Thank you.
The Urban Air Security Initiative.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
That's my motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion of the motion? Councilor Devlin?
I just want to be clear. So the council,
could you speak?
Sorry. The council item will have all the things that I abstained from.
Correct.
and not this letter.
Correct. That's the motion. The motion is that we would not be, we're taking no action on sending this letter to the Urban Area Security Initiative, and rather we will be sending a letter to, or recommending the council send a letter to Alameda County with the guidelines that we just voted on.
I'm not sure that, I mean, we hit everything. I'd have to see them side by side so that I could verify that what we just said is everything that's in here, which I don't, I can't do right now, but. Because there were some changes that were on here that, yeah, I don't know.
What will be the process for us to examine, to look at this document before it goes to the full council?
Yeah.
Well, we're gonna write this up and then send it to all the subcommittee members.
Maybe it could be a sense motion or something. I don't know if that's appropriate.
Well, we just adopted a set of recommendations. So what we send will reflect those recommendations.
Right.
Yeah. And so we'll send it out to everyone. Tano will work on trying to transcribe it. We'll send it around to verify accuracy of the motion.
And Cheryl, I just wanted to point out that if you find that something's missing that you want included, we have another shot at the council meeting. When this comes to the council meeting, we can always amend the or add to it at the council meeting.
Okay.
I'd
like to call a question.
Anything else?
Okay,
so is everyone clear the motion?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I wasn't clear. I was trying to say.
The motion is that we take no action on Councilmember Worthington's letter, and that we instead that we recommend that the City Council send a letter to Alameda County for the Board of Supervisors and Sheriff, I imagine, correct? Outlining our guidelines, proposed guidelines.
Okay, so I guess the letter will be to Alameda County Board of Supervisors, CCing, AHR, and CCing the Bay Area Urban Area Security Initiative?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Motion carries unanimously. Okay. Thank you. Good work. So item six, discussion and action extending the subcommittee past 1 year for two more meetings to conclude the work of the subcommittee. Councilwoman Wingrove.
We have 9 minutes to get this into the city clerk if we're going to do it. I just felt like there were so many issues that were unresolved, and we got the report, the draft report last week, and then the meeting was canceled. So we haven't really had time to go over the draft report. And so I just thought I should put this on the agenda. It looks like we're working very well today and we're making progress. So maybe we don't have to do it. If we can work informally,
please no.
After the sunset, to just verify and confirm Tano's work, which has been excellent, by the way. So. Probably it won't be an issue, but I just feel like we need some closure. So I don't know how other people think, but we just put it on as a safeguard because we have 9 minutes to get in it.
Okay, I appreciate you raising this for discussion. I would prefer that we not extend the subcommittee to meet further. I think we've done a lot of work. I think the things we discussed were going through these issues and specifically identifying or providing a response to these particular issues and questions that the council had referred to us, including the recommendations that we just made about the reconstitution of Urban Shield. All that would need to be included in the report that goes to council, in the council report. I think we can work to develop that and then circulate it around the subcommittee members to just verify accuracy of count of the committee's action and then send that to the council. I commit that we will have an inclusive process that will involve and get, seek the input of all members of the subcommittee.
So I just want to clarify, if this meeting was noticed from 3 to 5, does that mean we have to extend the meeting in order to continue working?
2:30.
We can continue working tonight?
Yes.
Okay, because there's still a lot on our agenda that we haven't gotten to. So, okay, just wanted to clarify. So I guess I just need to tell my aide whether or not to push the button on the extension.
Well, I would not support extending the life of the subcommittee. I think let's try to conclude this evening and move forward. And I see other council members shaking their heads, so it's hearing no motion to extend the subcommittee.
Okay.
Council member Dowell.
Yeah, I had a question on the UASI allocations on page 19.
I think we're not
there yet.
No,
okay.
That's the next slide.
All right.
Okay, so hearing no motion on item number 6, we will be taking no action on this. So we'll now go to item 7, review of final recommendations to the Berkeley City Council and report.
I wonder if I'm the wrong thing.
There was an, we added your item, Councilmember Wingrove.
Okay, I'm looking.
So now that's item number 7. The original agenda did not include your item, we added your item at your request. So item number 7, discussion and action review of final recommendation report to the Berkeley City Council. Councilmember Wingrove. And then Councilor Dowell.
So is now the time to address my issues about the report?
Yes.
Okay. So first of all, I didn't know the report was being written because the subcommittee never had a discussion to that effect. So I was actually quite shocked to find a very long and detailed report in my packet. That's the first problem that I had. My other problem with the report, and I'll discuss the content, I find the report extremely biased. It was my understanding that as a subcommittee, our charge was to collect information that the City Council had asked us to collect and to report back to them and provide that information to them. I did not hear the Council saying, please write me an extensive report on why Urban Shield is bad. And that's actually what I think we've gotten here, is a report that has a lot of editorial comment in it. It has excluded a lot of information. So I don't think that this is what the council wants to see, frankly. I appreciate all the work that went into it, but I don't think it focuses on answering the questions that we were asked to answer. I think it's more dictated by political ideology than by an assessment of the benefits of the training. And there are a lot of implicit assumptions in the report which I don't feel can be substantiated. So I have a long list of things, and Kate, as I suggested, I'm willing to spend time going over the report with you line by line, but I really think we need to focus on a succinct report that answers the questions that the City Council asked us to answer. I don't think the City Council is going to read a 37-page, nine-point font report. I mean, I just don't you know, we don't have the time. We have so much we have to deal with. So I would like to refocus our energy on creating a report that answers the specific questions that we were asked for in an objective way. That's my suggestion.
Councilmember Dowd.
I find that not to be a true statement, but anyway, my question is, I was wondering about the UASI allocations, and I think the report is good. It's our job to read these 30, however many pages. That's what we're here for. I'm confused as to why, so, I mean, that's it. But anyway, my question is on page 19, the state retention, and it's on this little chart of the UASI allocations. What is that for, was one of my questions.
For each allocation to each area of the country, the state keeps part of the money. So the federal government gives California a certain amount, and then they allocate it out, but they keep part of it for themselves. And I'm not sure what they do with that, frankly, because it's not part of our funding.
So it's like an administrative cost?
Yeah.
For the state. It's a lot of money. Interesting. Yeah, that's good information to have, actually. Let's see. And then I was wondering, because it talks about I just wanted to bring out a point on like page on 10. It talks about the seminars. And I just, from my observation when we were there in 17, there was little or no SWAT participation in the seminars. I just wanted to bring that to everyone's attention because that didn't seem like too many people were, I mean, I didn't see any SWAT teams in the room at the time. And also, let's see, I think that was it for right now. Let me just look real quick. I just wanted to also point out that the SRT gets 80 hours of mandatory training and 16 hours of monthly training. So, just want to make that sure everyone's aware of that, because they do get lots of training. And I think that's it for right now.
Thank you, Councilor Harris.
Well, clearly since the mayor's office and our office wrote the report, I don't find it biased. I think there's a lot of factual evidence presented here. There's a lot of history about where this funding came from and the origins of it, which I think is helpful to know. And there's also a discussion of the things that happened at Urban Shield, which is really important because we are not recommending, we have not in our previous meeting, recommended pulling out of Urban Shield. This is a misnomer. We've recommended pulling out of two aspects of Urban Shield, the tactical exercises and the vendor show. So I think it's really important we discuss what the rest of Urban Shield is. That's an important part of this section. Also, the section on the Board of Supervisors and what they've done, I think it's really important to us understanding the context of how we got into this discussion in the first place, because they were part of the impetus for us moving forward. And then we have long sections about the what other training the police and fire departments get, which I think is important to set the context. This is maybe an important training, but it's only one thing out of all the trainings received by the departments. And we do reflect a lot on the discussion that we've had, the meetings, the benefits to the fire department and to the police department. There's a whole section on this, as they expressed it at the meetings to us. They have a lot of benefits that they wanted to point out, and we talk about those. So I just want people to know that's there. And then we do an assessment. And it may be here that you find it too rhetorical, and I'm happy to talk to you about this. But if this committee votes not to put the report forward, I will put it forward as an amendment and supplemental too to the meeting. So regardless, this report will be in the record. So thank you.
Okay, I just want to say that I think whatever report goes to council, I think it's important to emphasize several things. One, the benefits that we have heard from our police department for participating in the program, the fact that there are no established negative outcomes for our police department participating in the program. I have not heard of a specific incident that was directly attributable to our police department's participation in Urban Shield. I have not, for my year of working on this, people can come to certain assumptions, but I have not seen a direct correlation. I think that's important to emphasize. And if there's a disagreement, I will emphasize that personally, because the concern I've heard is the sheriff and frankly, the lack of input from our city and our police department in helping develop this program. We do not control Urban Shield. That is the problem. I think if we had more of a voice and more of a role in helping shape this program, many, if not all of the concerns that we've heard would not exist. So I think it's important that we direct our focus on Alameda County and the sheriff, who are solely responsible currently for what this program looks like and how it functions, not our police department. They go in using our policies and procedures to respond to the specific exercises. Once again, I have not heard, and maybe I missed something, I have not heard of any established negative outcome from our police department's participation in Urban Shield. Councilmember Wingrat.
So, with regard to the vote that was taken last week, which I did not support, it's come to my attention that actually that vote may not be in compliance with our charter. And I'd like to distribute to you the section of the charter that I think applies. And I think that it would be in the best interest of the subcommittee to read this and perhaps reconsider the recommendation that we're going to send up to City Council.
We'll definitely take a look at this, but Councilor Harrison.
I can read for the public's
why don't we go over this?
So section 28 of the Berkeley City Charter, the city manager shall be responsible to the council for the implementation of council policy and for the efficient administration of all the affairs of the city. The city manager shall have the following powers and duties, and then if you skip down to B, except for the purpose of inquiry, the council and its members shall deal with the administrative service solely through the city manager, and neither the council nor any member thereof shall give orders to any of the subordinates of the city manager, either publicly or privately. C, to exercise control over all departments, divisions, and bureaus of the city government and over all the appointed officers and employees thereof. The violation of any provision of this charter or of any ordinance of the city may be deemed a misdemeanor and may be prosecuted by the authorities of the city in the name of the people of the state of California, or may be redressed by civil action at the option of said authorities. Any person sentenced to imprisonment for the violation of a provision of this charter or of any ordinance may be imprisoned in the city jail or if the council by ordinance shall so prescribe in the county jail or the county of a, it just goes on. Anyway, the other thing from Berkeley Municipal Code 2.64 regarding the police department. A police department is created which shall be under the direction of the chief of police, subject to the general administration direction of the city manager. I'm sorry, city manager, to bring this up, but I have been very concerned about the action that the subcommittee took last week, and so I went ahead and did a little research. Chief of Police Control and Supervisory Authority. The chief of police shall be responsible for the supervision and control of all divisions of the department and for the performance of the functions herein assigned to the department. 2.64.040, the chief of police, subject to the approval of the city manager, shall have authority to adopt rules and regulations for the administration, discipline, equipment, and uniforms of the members and officers of the department, fixing powers and duties, and prescribing penalties for violation of any such rules and regulations, and providing for their enforcement. So these are things that I unearthed in our Berkeley City Charter and the Berkeley Municipal Code, and when I talked about last week ramifications of the decision, I think, again, you may perhaps want to reconsider.
Thank you, Councilmember Harrison.
Yeah, these sections are indeed mature in the municipal code, but the parts that are ignored are the parts that deal with the policy powers of the city council. I don't see those here. We have a very specific role in the government, which is to set policy. We set constraints on what can be done by administration, and we set broad guidelines. My entire work is based on working on governance. I did that for the state of California and I do this overseas in many, many countries. And what that involves is figuring out how governing bodies work with administrations. We do not tell the city manager who to hire. We don't tell her how to supervise her employees. We're not involved in that level of administration, but policymaking does include setting the broad parameters of how the city is to operate. The budget is a very specifically identified area of council prerogative, and included in my work in governance is the setting of constraints on people's work. Were we to have a training where slaves were serving food, we would certainly be within our rights to say, we're not participating in that training. That violates our policy. I think this is a misnomer. It's a confusion of administration and policy. And it offends me that this is brought up now and was not agendized. I didn't know we were going to be discussing this now. I don't see that in the enumerated list. I thought we were going to be talking about the report, which you had mentioned to me, which is fine. So this has not been agendized, and so I think it's out of order to discuss it at this point. Thank you.
So on that, whether it's within the subject of the agenda item says discussion and action, review of final recommendations and report to council. So I guess my ruling would be that it review of final recommendations.
Even though I knew it would be controversial, I was polite enough to submit the report in advance. I did not need to do that. I was not required to do that. I think that's what you do with your colleagues. I don't think you hand this to your colleagues on the dais. So I'm objecting to it on that basis. Thank you.
Councilmember Dowd.
And I'm just wondering, do we need to vote to accept it?
No.
Not at subcommittees. Just checking. Yeah, I kind of find it insulting. I really do. I mean, I can't even, I'm just like blown away by this, actually. This is what we were, I don't even know how to articulate, because I think Councilmember Harrison did an excellent job as stating the policy, and if this wasn't something that we could do, I mean, this is like the second time this has happened within the last week. First it was the city manager, and now it's another council member. I mean, and she backed down. So I just don't understand why this is being brought up again, because this is why we were here, to decide if this was going to be a problem, then why did we spend a whole freaking year in a subcommittee with all the community, with over 500 people at a meeting, and how many signatures did they just get? Almost 1,000. I mean, that's some BS if I ever heard it. I don't get it. This is what we were, everybody knew what we were doing since last June. So why is this even an issue right now? And why didn't this come up a year ago? I mean, that's ridiculous to me. Why waste our time?
I think that task force has, the subcommittee has actually done some very valuable work. And I think that the guidelines that we're sending to council are extremely important. And I think that the reason why this is coming up now is because at the last meeting you took a vote. And that vote says that our police department cannot do something, cannot participate in the tactical training and the vendor show. So that's why this becomes relevant now, because we took a vote on something that's operational, not policy.
We were,
and it's, it, excuse me, I'm four.
I see that.
So that's to explain why I brought it forward now. It's in response to the vote you took, which I realized later may be inappropriate. I'm not a lawyer, I don't know, but I think it might be, because the charter very clearly says that this is in the purview of the city manager and the police chief. The policy decisions are the guidelines that we're sending. Those are the recommendations that we're sending. That's the policy, and we're doing that.
But the whole time, our options, our decisions were to either pull out or stay in. Everybody knew that was on the table from day freaking one. I don't get it.
Councilor Anderson.
Okay, I'm gonna bore you with a government lesson. When I worked for the Judicial Council of California, which it guides all of the courts of the state, so all 58 county court systems, we had this body, the Judicial Council, and we operated under what was known as the Carver Principles. Jay Carver is an academic that works on governance. The Carver Principles said that we set general policy and we set constraints, as I mentioned earlier. As an example, this is a very facile example, but it makes it easy to understand. Policy bodies say, we want you to make a cup of coffee, and they can also say, you can't add sugar. They can't tell you to use a Melitta. They can't tell you what brand to buy. They can't tell you all the other stuff, but they can set general what we want and what we specifically don't want. And what we've said we specifically don't want is to participate in Urban Shield this year while the rest of this work is taking place. I feel it's a misunderstanding of our role. I find it challenging to have someone else, people that sit on the body, want to undercut the authority of this body. I find that odd. I really respect our city manager. She's done an excellent job. Our police chief is doing an excellent job. But this is within our purview. And if forced, I will find a lawyer to make that point. I think this is an extremely irregular thing to bring up in this way. And I also don't, in a sense, see the point of it. The community has been speaking to us. When I say that to people, some people in the council, they'll say, well, what community? All I see are, you know, white people out here. And I think that's because the people that are most harmed by the police have jobs. They cannot come during the daytime. I was at Juneteenth yesterday, and I was talking with Ms. Schwartz and a fellow friend of mine who's an African-American, and he said, when we see the SWAT team, we feel they're coming for us. I don't feel that way because the SWAT team doesn't come to my neighborhood. Let's be realistic. It's not wrong that people have different perceptions. I really disagree with the mayor. There's no proof that there's harm from these SWAT teams. We have Black Lives Matter happen. I know the chief has worked very hard since then to work on de-escalation, but we have issues with racial disparities in Berkeley. Those can't be denied. They're in the CPE report. It's a weak excuse to say, well, we're not as bad as other people. I don't see that as our goal. We're Berkeley. We're supposed to be great. That's the city I live in, is a great city, a city that aspires to the best. We do that in so many ways in the police department. I don't think Urban Shield reflects our best. And so it concerns me that we would even be discussing this after this entire year of discussion. I don't really have anything else to say. I'm certainly not going to entertain this at the moment. Thank you.
I just weighed on this. So I will admit I am frustrated that this question of whether this is within our legal authority under the charter and the municipal code is coming up this late in the process. As we know, this issue was raised a couple weeks ago, immediately after the subcommittee's vote. It's regretful that our prior city attorney, who was monitoring this whole process, did not provide good legal advice to the city council. A year ago, when we were discussing this very issue, even at the June 20th meeting, when we voted to create the subcommittee, I think it would have been helpful to have some sense of what is within our legislative authority and what is an administrative action. That being said, we are where we are. I guess I have a question. This kind of raises a whole other question that I just thought about, which I guess, Chief, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but if you know the answer, I appreciate it. So we're talking about training, which is something that's probably in the memorandum of understanding with EPA and probably subject to meet and confer. Similarly, the discussion around the charter amendment for the Police Review Commission, certain elements of that were subject to meet and confer under the MOU. Would this action that the council, the subcommittee is recommending, would that be separate, maybe Madison Manager, you might know the answer, would that be subject to meet and confer under the MOU?
I'm the police chief, not the city attorney.
I think city managers may know the answer.
The MOU and the chief has the MOU up.
So, Mr. Mayor, I can respond. Under section 45.1 of the MOU between the City of Berkeley and the Berkeley Police Association, it explicitly gives training responsibility to the city manager. Responsibility for developing training programs for employees shall be assumed by the city manager. Such training programs may include lecture courses, demonstrations, assignments of reader matter, or such other devices as may be available for the purposes of improving the efficiency and broadening the knowledge of municipal employees in the performance of their duties. As a result of it being in the MOU, this would also be subject to the decision of the subcommittee and or subsequent action by the council. As it relates to this MOU, will be subject to meet and confer.
So, but it also sounded like, just listening to what you said, that decisions on training are within the authority of the city manager. City council.
Correct.
So I'm a little, while I didn't vote for the motion last meeting, I'm troubled by the potential that an action we took could be in violation of the city charter or municipal code. It's never, certainly not my intention to do that. I've been on the council for 10 years, and there are certain functions that are solely administrative, and there are certain functions that are legislative. The guidelines that we just adopted are policy recommendations. That's within our role under the city charter. I am a little concerned about whether this is an operational decision, particularly given what I just heard from the city manager, and whether we can take this action. I don't want to violate the city charter, I'm just being honest with you, or the municipal code. I'm not here to break laws. And so I want to make sure what I'm doing is within my authority under the law. And decisions on training, I've never known to be within council's authority. And that's an operational decision. We could say that we don't want to participate in training that's racist, and but there also, there is no, how this came up was because of the MOU compendium that we were voting on last year, and specifically the MOU with the Urban Area Security Initiative. That's how this whole thing has come up in the past. It's been within the MOU compendium. There is no funding directly tied to this. There's no budget request. So I will admit I'm very frustrated. I know I conveyed this frustration to the council members and the city manager that this is coming up now. I do think, however, this process has been actually very beneficial and informative. It's not often that we hear from the community. It's not often we hear from the police department and fire about and have an in-depth review of a particular policy issue. I think the recommendations that we've made to Alameda County on guidelines are really meaningful, and I think I'm committed to work to try to really try to influence that process to reflect the recommendations that council may adopt. Once again, I think the focus is on the sheriff and on Alameda County, and because they're the ones that are deciding and running and funding this program. So I guess I have real concern about the subcommittee's action given these questions that have come up. I don't want the city council to take an action that's legally inappropriate or vulnerable to legal challenge. There's issues around the meet confer process, issues within the MOU saying training is explicitly within the authority of the city manager. So I have serious concern about whether we can take the action council, the subcommittee took. And for that purpose, I'm going to be, I do not want my vote attached to that motion. I don't want to be associated with an action that could be potentially illegal and outside of our legislative authority. I do have concern about Urban Shield. I want to shape Urban Shield, but I don't want to do something that is going to put the city at legal risk and council at legal risk.
Where's the opinion that says that, though? I think that's the problem we're having, is that line again, as we're saying, between policy and administration. I haven't seen a legal opinion that says that. I see nothing before us. You're making this assertion based on comments made at the last minute. By the way, this meeting was supposed to end at 5, and I have to leave in 6 minutes to go see my mother. But the point is, you're making this assertion based on comments made at this meeting. Without the rest of the charter in front of us, and without any other evidence, we do not have a city attorney opinion. We do not have an opinion from, for example, the ACLU or other experts in governmental affairs. I think we should not be doing this at this moment. I'm stunned that you are going to withdraw your vote at a moment like this. And I'm going to be leaving now, because I did promise my mother to take her to dinner. It's her 94th birthday. Thank you. Aww. Bye.
And I'm also going to leave because I'm just like appalled if this is true and the city attorney hasn't weighed in, that's ridiculous to me. I mean, what's she doing? If this was really true, then why didn't she freaking send something to be read at this meeting today?
Councilmember Wingraff.
So I would like to suggest before you depart that we send the guidelines to the city council.
They will be sent to the
city council. Your plan all the way. Just make
they will
sure
be sent to the city council.
Okay, well,
they've
gone. Goodbye.
So we made a recommendation that will be in the report to city council. The recommendation on the paper that will be in the report to city council. I think these motions will be, these proposals will be in the report to city council. The council can evaluate all this information. Madam City Manager.
Mr. Mayor, the hostility shown to my city attorney, she's not even here in the audience, I find it very disrespectful.
I was referring to the former city attorney, just to be clear, not
Your statement, but I also feel as if the disrespect that's shown to our city attorney and the language that she used in addressing any absence of an opinion that has not been formally requested.
I was expressing my personal opinion, not an opinion from the city attorney.
So part of it for me is that while a lot of this is maybe fresh and new to many, this is not a new comment. My desk, my office, has repeatedly stated, both formally and behind scenes, that I believe there's an absolute erosion of a city manager responsibility before my time and during my time. So these are not new assumptions or assertions. These things have been very implicit and explicitly stated with this council. So I just want to be very clear about that. This isn't new. We've been talking about Urban Shield for a long time. And whether it's been in a formal setting or behind the scenes and talking with council members and explaining the position of this city manager's office and the position of the police department, it's been very clear. We believe we should have a voice and a seat at the seat in the Urban Shield program to actually address and dictate the type of change that we want to see. Pulling us out of that role, I think, is detrimental.
So, these questions have come up since our vote. In reading this, and hearing what you said, as as much as I have serious concern about Urban Shield, I don't want to do something that's illegal. That's my concern. I mean, I don't feel like that's my role. I don't think I took an oath to do that. So I know it's frustrating as it is to people. It's frustrating to me that we didn't have this analysis from Mr. Callen a year ago when there were multiple conversations at the city council about this. There were like two meetings in this chamber, and there was a special meeting. And no, at that time, I do not recall this specifically coming up. I'm not dissing Ms. Brown. I'm talking about the former city attorney. Maybe he was already retired, out the door. You know, it is what it is. Councilmember Wingrove, I think we're adjourned technically.
We are technically adjourned, but I want to make one comment. It was never my intention to dictate whether or not we could participate or not participate in any of the elements of Urban Shield. It was my intention to gather information and to give that information to the city council. So I know that there are some people here who are very determined to prohibit our police department from participating in Urban Shield, but I want to make very clear that was not what we were asked to do.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it was. It was
we were asked to research, observe, and gather information about alternatives to Urban Shield, about what other cities are doing, to learn more about the other trainings that our first responders take part in. Urban Shield is a very small part of all of the trainings that our uniformed people, our first responders, participate in. It's 48 hours a year for maybe six people. That's what we're talking about. We need to put this in context. So I just want to say,
and to ultimately I did not have to participate.
That was not my goal.
Both or neither of the programs. It is exactly
in
your charge.
It's in the charge.
You are adjourned. I am not out of order. You are adjourned. This is part of your charge. You assumed this charge, Susan, a year ago. You assumed it. So you are in violation if you work for a year with this charge.
And I know you like to smirk at democracy, but what he just read was the charge of this subcommittee. That's why we've all
been in charge of your subcommittee.
And I think it's despicable that you would threaten other council members with what you did in terms of the charter about it's illegal, da-da-da-da-da. It's just...
Jesse, get fine. Do something.
Yeah, really.
We're done.
Thank you, Christine.
You're welcome.